shall we carry on? So, I was hoping to do stuff in 2D. So it looks like I won't do that, but as I said, I'll give you the notes for them. Also, this 1D stuff, a number of us have been playing around with it over the years and using it. So, Will Parnell and I have long-standing contract to publish a book on homogenization theory, and we will get to that eventually. So these are notes for sort of partly from that. So I should thank Will and also Paul for many discussions over the years for 1D problems. So we were talking just now in the coffee break where they came from. So they've been around forever. People have studied them. So we just reinvent them over and over again because they're so much fun and so easy to deal with. But what I want to do in this lecture, and I'm going to have to get a move on if I want to cover any decent amount of ground, is to talk about homogenization directly. So using an asymptotic method to go through and get the results without, in a way, solving the multiple scattering problem. So that's the name of the game. And you do this when it's too hard. So the problem you pose is really very, very complicated. So you want to take the low frequency limit, which will enable you to simplify it down so that you can either do sort of some stuff numerically or hopefully analytically to construct a solution. And this is, as I said, the next order problem from the D problem, which has got some structure to it. So we have a parameter A, which recognizes the discontinuity point between the mass, the string of density row 1 and the string of density row 0. I'll write it down in dimensional variables back again. And I'm going to introduce this thing alpha squared. Okay, the problem. So alpha squared is a discontinuous function, which is 1 in 0 region. So this is, and it's k squared in the 1 region. This is the 1 region. And when I mean 1 region, I mean the properties of it. So it's the periodic distribution of these, and they're spaced out that way. And we call the host, we imagine that the host medium is the one that we started with, and then we've added in bits of other stuff. So we implicitly sort of think about it as A is small, but in this problem, you don't. If you make A 10 to 1, then you replace all of the row 0 stuff with row 1 stuff, and we would just get a uniform homogeneous string with wave number K1 rather than K0. And that k squared there is the ratio. K1 squared, K0 squared. K0 squared, as before, is only the squared row 0 over t, K1 squared. Okay. Again, we like to introduce everything in terms of dimensional variables. The things we play with. And you can see when I go to dimensionless coordinates, the L would disappear. I have an A. A is dimensionless. So A is the sort of ratio of the inclusion to the host. So this is, we often call this the host phase, or the component, and this is the inclusion in the parlance of various subjects. So what do we expect? So we expect the solution to be periodic with period L on the short scale. Scale on the long scale, scaled on, and 1 over k naught. So k naught is units 1 over length, so 1 over k naught is like a wavelength, which is 2 pi over r, or lambda. So this is lambda over 2 pi. So imagining long waves, and I can set the waves to be long by adjusting the frequencies. So I'm looking for low frequency waves with respect to this lambda L. And I seek solutions of that form which take into account properly the inclusion. Okay. So the aim is to obtain the asymptotic effective behavior one goes to zero, where epsilon is again k naught L. Directly. I need to avoid solving the full because we're going to have to resort to some numerical method or something to approximate the solution because it's a bit too difficult to write down in general. In this case, it's probably to do it. So, which is in general too hard to solve directly. So you choose an asymptotic method which exploits the small parameter. So many of you, hopefully, will have done courses on asymptotic. But there's not so many courses that you do as an undergraduate which teaches you asymptotics from a sort of physics point of view where we're doing real problems. Usually you're just introduced to, you know, matched asymptotic extensions, multiple scales, you know, two timing methods, other things. There's a whole plethora of asymptotic approaches. The natural one in this case, you could use the one that you like, but I'm going to use multiple scales. So here we will use multiple scales. Okay. So multiple scales method, as it implies, is you introduce either different time scales or different length scales, or a mixture of the two in the problem. You may have loads of them, you know, hundreds of different length scales and time scales. Here, I said we've got two natural scales. One is a wavelength, the other is natural small scale. So we will use, because we're in the frequency domain, the frame time away, we'll use two scales, two length scales. So we use two scales. So, introduce the fast or long short scale. Because they use the time problems as well as space, we often call them short or fast scales. If I say fast, I mean short. And that's going to be the natural one for the problem. And use a capital X to denote. So for some reason, in my local problems, I always use capitals in all of my papers. So I suppose I should use capitals, implies it's big. It's the wrong way around. Okay, and now we need the long scale. Now, I'm not going to do the obvious one. The obvious one would be x. But I'm not going to do that. So I'm going to make it more general. And I'm going to be x and L over L of epsilon. And let me explain why. First of all, I should say what L is. It's an expansion in epsilon of the form I've argued with L ever since he was in short trousers, but why do I need L epsilon? Okay. Why this scaling? I'm not a fixed bar if K or X. So little x is my long scaling. Little x. You have to remember that. Little x without a bar on means a dimensionless, but it's scaled on the long scale. And the relationship between the physical scale is posed in terms of an asymptotic expansion. Why am I doing that rather than testing it? Okay. The reason is because we're going to get an expansion, we're going to pose. U, the displacement of U naught of epsilon U1, epsilon squared U2, etc. Now, you know, there's lots of assumptions in that asymptotic. There could be logarithms in that expansion. It may have fractional powers. I trust that it's just regular in epsilon, and then I try it. If it doesn't work, something doesn't work. It's inconsistent in my asymptotic scheme, and I go back and revisit it, so I put it and see. Let's see what happens. But why am I helping this on its way by introducing this strained scaling? So this is called a strained coordinate system. Well, because I'm expecting an answer which will be U is wavelength. So I'm going to expect something like this something for my problem. Okay. But U is made up of these asymptotic problems, and I'm going to solve these in a sequence. If I did the first one, I would get like an e to the gamma naught. That would be my first solution. And then I'd solve, and I'd get some correction. It would be something that's wavy. But remember, this is going to be an approximation to the real wavelength. It's going to be an asymptotic expansion for the wavelength. So that's really going to be like gamma 1 squared gamma 2. That's what I want. I want something. So essentially, some of these higher powers have to go up there into the phase. I wouldn't worry about it normally, but because I want this to hold for all x bar, then I have to have a consistency so that any small change in the wave number here will lead to a change in the phase over a long time, over a long distance. So this L allows me to strain my coordinates so that I take that into account. So it puts all the wavy bits up into this exponent, and I can get better and better corrections for this. How does that work? It's because of that transformation. I'm going to get something which is going to look like gamma x, and then when I change back, I'm going to get L epsilon, and as I get higher and higher corrections, and then more, I'm always correcting this thing. And building that into that. So I'm getting the phase right all the time. So I'm correcting for this. So if you solve a local problem, and you assume periodicity and do everything, you'll get this slow drift in your answer because your gamma there is multiplied by something which can be as big as your height. So locally it's right, but it drifts, so that's why you need these strain coordinates. And I won't have time to go high enough order to see that, but we will go wrong. And if you think about it, if I've got an e to the I gamma, or epsilon, gamma 1, x in there, and I've not built it into here, when I'm going to get it in here as an x term. So I'll get a growing term, because it's asymptotically, it will come down here. So unless I adjust the phase for that L, then I will get growing terms in my solution. I think that's understandable, but when you see my notes, you get it. Anyway, I'm going to take liberties now. So I'm going to assume this is correct. Okay, the extension. And then the other thing we do, which if you're not familiar with asymptotic, seems very strange, is we let u bar of x bar be a function of two variables, little x and big x, where we treat little x and big x as independent variables. So this is very weird when you first do this. How do we treat? We know they're related to x bar. They're the same thing. But how can we treat them independently? Well, the question to ask you is, why not? Why don't we do it and see what happens? And you see it's all self-consistent. The miracle of asymptotic methods is that they work, and sometimes you can prove things, sometimes you can't. So, the first thing that happens is we're going to make things work. We're going to turn a very simple ODE into a PDE because we've got two independent variables. And we're going to asymptotically expand U, the displacement. So we're going to get a whole hierarchy of problems here. It becomes a big mess. And hopefully each problem at each order is a nice problem that we can actually solve. And the other thing is what we're expecting is that in the small scale, on the big X problem, we won't see it as a wavy problem at all. But the waves are not propagating. They're propagating with such a long variation that locally they just look like periodic problems or something. But they're certainly not wave-like, so we will lose Helmholtz equation in the process. That's what we're expecting, but then we'll collect it and pick it up later on. So if I could just get through to the end of proving the effective wave equation, which will be boring, nevertheless, that will have shown you. So the first thing we do, so we need to know what the derivative is of our wave equation. Well, if we're changing variables, it's d by dx, d by d little x, alpha, so long scale, short scale, and then this is dx by dx bar plus little x by the x bar, and we have those relations here. So the big x by the x bar is 1 over L. Can you see that? 1 over L. And the, so bring this over to the other side, we have big L over little L, the x by the x bar. Big L of epsilon over little l d by dx. So my operator d by dx bar becomes this sum of two variables. Obviously, I've got to plug it into the Helmholtz equation, so I need to differentiate it again. It's 1 over L squared, d2 by d big X squared, squared epsilon and up there L starts with epsilon because to leave the yield, if I put all the other L constants away, then I would have what I've written down there, x by k naught x. So you can think of this like epsilon, this is like epsilon squared. So I can multiply out. I'm going to leave that x L squared, so I've got epsilon squared, 2L2, epsilon cubed, L3, epsilon 4. So we have to plug that into the Helmholtz equation, all of that stuff, and it's going to blow up. Okay. Plug into the Helmholtz equation. I'm putting a plug here. Just a hot spot cord. Okay. Right. So what do? We plug it in. We'll get that second derivative term. Okay. So we have d2 by dx squared. We've got that, and the L squared down here. And that was plus the second derivative k naught squared alpha squared. I introduce the alpha if you look back to your notes. So you get d2 by the big x squared. A lot of writing down, I'm afraid, but it's got to be done. So that's my form before I put in the expansions for L and U. And remember that this thing is that, remember that discontinuous function. Which is 1 in 0. And k squared in the 1 region. Because you remember, 0 is my host phase and 1 is the inclusion phase. Okay. I should also say what I said at the end before we stop the coffee. Finally, I've said finally twice here. Finally, we require continuity of U and its derivative everywhere. So, across the interfaces. So where we change from the one phase to zero and the zero to the one, we need to put in continuity of U and the derivative. Yeah, well, with just about the x bar, exactly right. So then we're going to plug in the x bar as the two partial derivatives, and then we're going to do some bookkeeping. And I'll write that down. On the interface. Let's put it like that for now. Interfaces and the U bar by the X bar. So you're used to this notation. You differentiate to the right at the interface in the one region and the zero region, and then you take the difference and that must be the erase. In dimensional variables. So really we've got to write down this big mess now. So what do we get? D2 by the x squared plus epsilon squared 1 plus 2 L2 epsilon plus 2 L3 plus L2 squared epsilon squared dot 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 D2 by the x squared plus 2 epsilon 1 plus L2 epsilon plus L3 plus square. So I'm carrying on here plus epsilon squared alpha squared U0 plus epsilon U1 U2 So we've got that equation, just doing these expansions, and then we've got the jump or continuity. Here we have U0 plus epsilon U1. We're going to call that Mr. B1 somewhere, should have a B1. I'll call that. I don't think I've used this equation. Let's use that as 1. This is 2. Okay. And then we have. And we have that jump condition. The question is, as you said, really, where's the interface? The big scale doesn't really see these interfaces anymore. But we can think about them as on the short scale. A, 1, 1 plus A. So, we can expand everything out, and we have to, and then we make the assumption that the U's don't contain any of the epsilons, at each order U0, U1, U2, the problem doesn't have epsilon floating around with it. In order for that to happen, it must mean that every problem that we look at for that order must be consistent and satisfied and the boundary value problem is the same. So we treat all of these UNs as independent problems, and we try and solve them. If you notice, I haven't said anything about forcing independence. I haven't put in any force in terms. So essentially, what we're trying to do is get out an effective wave equation without actually solving for it. I'm sorry for all of you who use these methods all the time. This is very tedious. But if people haven't seen it, then it's actually quite subtle, the ideas. So, I'll just say what each UN satisfies a boundary value problem periodic convergent problem. Independent of epsilon. That's the assumption. If they did, then that expansion would have epsilons embedded in these, and then the asymptotic expansion is wrong. So that's the name of the game. So what we do, for those unfamiliar with this, is we start from the lowest order and from the power order. So solve each problem in turn. So we look for the epsilon rule or the constant problem. So what's the constant problem here? So all that stuff in brackets multiplying the dt by the little x squared term is zero to lead in order. If the other term is, we've got that term. This is small. So we have d2 u naught by d big x squared. We have u naught plus minus u naught and du naught by d plus minus. 0. So, sorry. You see here that I've just taken this term times that term, and this term is the only one I need. Just push that a little bit further, and you can see that. Hopefully, you can see all those, because I'll come back to those again. Okay, we've got this problem, and recall U naught must be periodic in some fashion, because it, whether I have my coordinates centered here or go one along and one along, the problem looks the same. Okay. So what sort of solutions? I can integrate this, can't I? So u naught is equal to a plus big X B. Okay, this is PDE, no x's appear. So I've integrated these can be functions of the long variable. So those are, that's your general solution. And we can have naught, one in the scaling, and this is a. So think about it, we can have like a linear, we can only have linear functions. Something like that. But we, for these functions, we can have a different A and B in both sides. So we could, you know, have that. But this has to then be periodic. So the thing has to look the same here and here and here. But think about it. Our continuity conditions here say the slope and the function has to be the same. So what does that tell me? What function satisfies periodicity? It's a straight line, yes, a constant. So therefore, P must be zero. So obviously, you can't have something which is periodic. The only periodic function is a constant in big X. Because I haven't got any jumps that allow me to sort of kick in. So to leading order, it doesn't sort of see the discontinuity. U naught is a function of little x only. As expected. So, to leading order, in, you can't expect when you're looking at a material, you can't see all that wiggly stuff at the higher, the low order. If you do, then you know you've got an interesting material. Generally, you can't see it. So that's what we were expecting. So we'll write it. U naught is A of X. And that's our solution. So, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, So we've done enough of the order. Let's go to order epsilon 1. We get very similar problems. Except now, we get that term, don't we? We get that times the U1, which is order epsilon, and then we look for another epsilon, we get this leading term here, but it must be multiplied by the U0, so it's got that partial, but it's got the two derivatives. Sorry? Something on the table, yeah? What's this thing? Zero, because, yeah, we've got the big X. And then we've got U1. Just slightly rewrite the way I write down these sort of continuity conditions, just to make sure that you understand it when you're looking through the notes. Slightly different way. And then the jump condition is the U1 by the big X plus D. Now we replace U0 by that. Okay. Again, this is zero. Oh, no, this isn't zero, is it? But it's not zero because A is A dash to the function X. But is it zero? Well, U naught is continuous. So it's no jump. And I'm asking for the jump across here. So this is still zero. So it's zero across the jump. A is a continuous function, it's not discontinuous, but that's zero. So therefore we have, for the U1 problem, we've got this is equal to zero. The jumps are all zero in the function, and the slope is zero. The same as the original problem. So you find this in lots of asymptotic problems. The next order is as boring as the first one. And you just get a constant. Does everyone agree with that? So, U1 problem, same as for U0, hence U1 is equal, I call it C of X, we've introduced the building one before, equals C. So again, no big X dependence. That's the second problem, order of squared. Okay. Order X of squared, I'll write it down. And check it, please, as I'm doing it to make sure I don't make mistakes. That it's the operator with a 1 in front of it times the U2 term plus U2 U1 big X. And now the first of those L's appear. It's not going to play any role here. But for the first time now, alpha squared pops up. Okay, that's the first time we have this function which has this jump within it. Right, this u1 is c of x, not dependent on big x, so that's 0. Nor is u0. This is a, this is a. So, into u2 by dx squared equals minus d2 a by dx squared plus alpha squared. So this is the first inhomogeneous equation we've got. Inhomogeneous problem for u2. And then this thing is, you know, piecewise constant. I'm changing to a full derivative because a doesn't depend on big x, it's only on little x. So I can cut the partial stuff. And I know some people don't like it. It makes it clear in your head that that's only a function of little x. The right hand side starts looking wavy again. Because it's not giving us anything. So these are functions of little x, but this is a piecewise constant function, which is a function of big x, isn't it? Because it jumps up and down. So we have to take that into account. We've also got our continuity in jump conditions. So we have u2 plus minus is 0, x equals 0 and a, and then we have d u2 by d big x, and u1 by d little x. L2 to U0 by D little x plus minus okay, U1 is continuous across the jump, so this was U0. Okay, so the derivatives are as well. Okay, that's 0. So the U2 is also continuous. And its slope is continuous across those jumps. Okay, so we have a little bit more work to do now. It's not as trivial as before, because we can integrate this thing, and then we have some force into it. So we have, you know, an e plus f times big x plus this, and we want something which is periodic. It's got the jump conditions are all zero, so there's no slope jumps, it's all zero, but we can have a right-hand side, and because of that alpha squared, we're going to have some things different inside the inclusion and outside. And as I said, we can split up the region and then plot what it is, and that thing in each region is like a constant, isn't it? The one has had, there's a different constant in there and there because one's got a 1 inside there and one's got a k squared. So basically we have like a c1 and a c0, and then integrating that gives me an x squared term, doesn't it? So I'm now allowed to have functions which are sort of, you know, quadratic. So it's possible that I can actually get solutions of this which are non-trivial. Which actually, so it has got some big x dependence rather than the constant, which satisfies this. So let's see. And indeed, that will give us a consistency condition for what a must satisfy. And that's the way it works. But rather than solving that, I can do it in a simpler way by just integrating it once. So integrating that equation with respect to big x, and then evaluating the limits, both inside, integrated here and here, get the limits, and then take the difference between the two, which will be to give me the jumps, and then the jumps are zero. So therefore, I can actually solve the problem. So let's do that. So we can avoid integrating. Let's give that equation a number. Can anyone remind me what number it must be? That's not a good number. 5. 5, okay. And then we've got 6 and 7. Okay. We can avoid integrating 5 and integrating. Sorry, let me say that again. We can avoid solving 5 by integrating 1 over each region. But if I do that, I can write down integral a to 1, the 0 region, d2u2 by the big x squared and big x. Integrate that, I get the u2 by the big x. And this is the top term is this thing, as we go up to 1, minus the u2, the big x, as we go down to x. And then if we take the right-hand side, that's a constant with respect to big x. And in that region, we're in the naught region, so alpha squared is 1. So we get minus d2 a by dx squared plus a. And then we get big x evaluated at 1 minus a. We got that. No, I won't disturb that board. We do the same again in the one region. And then we can just take the difference or add them depending on how it works out to get the jump conditions that we get. Integral 0 to a d to u2 by the big x squared dx to u2 by the big x, going up to n minus the u2 by the big x, as we go down to 0, and that's equal to minus a. Thank you. A, and that's just got an A there, hasn't it? Integral of constant is x, x do not level z. Okay. So, now, this has a periodic solution. So, my notation means that u2 by the big x, if I go up to 1, is the same as if I have the u2 by the x going up to 0. Because the whole thing will repeat itself. So, this one, I can say it's the limit as I go up to 1. So now we can add the two equations. So what do we get? We get minus the u2 by the big x plus minus across the line x equals 0 minus the U2 by the X plus minus cross X equals A is, it's just the sum of the right-hand sides. We get minus D2A by the X squared plus, and we have K squared A plus 1 minus A is A. But the conditions 6 and 7, well, it's just 7, isn't it? So this is 0, this is 0 from 7. So, D2A by the X squared plus K squared A plus 1 minus A is 0. And this is my first homogenized wave equation. So this is leading order homogenized wave equation. It's u naught, isn't it? Just a function of little x, and it satisfies that. So I'm allowed any solutions of that. And you can see it's sort of the obvious thing that you would get. You've got a weighted average of wave numbers. The wave number in the one phase is k squared, so it's multiplied by the area of that, or length plus. This has got wave number one in the scale there of times the weighted average of that. So it's a weighted average of the two. So it's sort of obvious. Lots of people could just write down, but we sort of formally proved it. I think that's very important. And with all these asymptotic methods, you've got to, you get your function, and then you've got to go to higher and higher order to evaluate it. So, summarize. It gets harder and harder to solve at higher order. And I will just write down what L2 and L3 are in that expansion. The general solution is therefore my general solution is that. If we put x naught in at the right order, the leading order, then that leading order and so k naught k squared a plus 1 minus a is K1 squared A plus 1 minus A. K1 squared. So I didn't need the L's. This order, but they're in there, and I would be wrong to just stick with this relationship here. It's only a leading order approximation. So, we proceed to higher orders in epsilon and solve each problem to add corrections. In particular, the next order is not too bad. You can use the same trick of integrating. Okay. The order x on cube problem says that L2 is zero. L2 is multiplying the epsilon. And as we found with the B problem, our expansion was in terms of epsilon squared. So I was sort of expecting that. L2 is 0. So you have to work even harder. You go to epsilon to the 4th. It's a blooming pain to solve that problem, but if you do that, I can't find a way of not actually integrating. They're all simple functions, you know. The worst is you have to think about cubics. But then you apply continuity, and then in that problem it's a little bit more subtle, you get a right-hand side, and then you have to avoid growing terms. Okay, to avoid growing terms, that's a secularity condition. And finally we start thinking in terms of secularity condition. And that's where L3 comes in, and that gives you, and I write it down in this form. So that is the first correction. And just as we found for our B that we expanded the dispersion relation, we got the leading term and then the epsilon squared correction, that goes up to the exponent to modify the exponent to give you the phase factor being right. Okay. So that's the thing which makes these things a little bit more interesting than problems, non-wavy problems. Okay. I don't think I'll write down the effective one, but I think on the problem sheet, I'm not sure if I'm right, but I said to you, how do you go from this problem to the bead problem? Okay, obviously, you've got to let A go to zero, but then you've got to think carefully how then you recover the bead problem. But if you take this solution here, and maybe if you allow me 1 minute, I'll write it down so it can help the students then recover the expansion for gamma that I wrote down earlier. Yeah, 5, 7, 6 there. I had the 24, that was in there before, yeah. Yeah, I don't know why. So essentially, and then if you put this in, you see what we're doing here is we've got that's our leading order sort of effective wave number, and then we've got this scaling to get us correct, and then we've got the L3 now. And that gives us k naught k squared a, just 1 minus a, 1 plus, and then we have that thing there. So that looks like, as you say, the second term having the expansion. Okay, so how does that recover that speed result? And you can get it very easily. Okay, so time for me to wrap up. I had hoped I would just say something about 2D homogenization, which is sort of doing exactly the same way. But instead of having derivatives, we have gradients, because it's a 2D and 3D vector, so it's gradients instead of replaces, you know, the partial derivatives. And then, in some sense, because 2D is a bit easier, we have two boundaries in the 1D problem. But, you know, once we have objects, we've only got one boundary, which leaves Green's theorem. In the plane, for the D0 and the D1 regions, you know, the inner and outer, but D1 and the D0. And we can use the trick of Green function, and we can get a very nice result for an effective weight equation in terms of all of the properties which sort of appear. And as I said, I'll give you those in my lecture as well. I think that might place the stop. Lunch.